Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see everybody on this beautiful day the Lord has made. Before I pray, you might be wondering why on earth am I using my mask and why I'm sitting so far back today. And the answer is because Zechariah will be preaching later on. And since we're limited on the number of microphones we have, this allows him to get to preach later on without everything that I've been breathing out and hovering over here around him. So that's why I have this today. But let's begin this service with prayer. Oh, loving God, we thank you for this day you have made. We thank you for the gift that it is. We ask that you would, especially on this All Saints Day, bring to mind those who have gone before us, who have paved the way for us to be here today. We thank you for their wisdom, for their sacrifices, for their belief not only in you, but also in us. And ask that as we go through this time of worship this morning, that you would form us more fully into people who will be just as concerned and have belief in those who follow after us, that they might know you and serve you. We thank you and pray this in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome to Mount Zion Methodist Church. So glad to have you here today. Hopefully those of you that were watching the football game have recovered. definitely have to come to church. I did some praying yesterday. I have a few announcements to draw your attention to. One, you'll see in the bulletin an announcement from Clemson Community Care. And this is the time of year at Clemson Community Care where we need turkeys. So if you go to your local grocery store in town and purchase a turkey, you can let them know that that's for Clemson Community Care, and someone from CCC will come pick that up. So need lots of turkeys to make this happen. If you're not able to do a turkey, you could also make a donation to Clemson Community Care, and they can purchase a turkey for you. Bible study continues outside of the parsonage or on Zoom on Tuesdays at 6:30. Zoom Sunday School continues at 9:30 every Sunday morning. Virtual United Methodist Women meeting is 2:30 this Wednesday. So the Zoom information is in your bulletin. And then the last thing I'll draw your attention to is Samaritan's Purse Operation Christmas Child. We always have a huge turnout every year with boxes up here, and it's really impressive. So I have been worried that because of not having people here in person, that we won't have as many boxes. So I encourage you to, if you're here, get a box. But if you're at home watching, get in contact with me. Jonathan probably would help too. But I will bring a box to your house, or we can actually, our kids could help pack extra boxes if you'd like. So just let me know if you want that to happen, and I'll get some extra boxes. Are there any more announcements? All right, please join me for the prayer of confession found in your bulletin. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our responsive reading today is found in our bulletins. Psalm 51 through 8, and then verses 22 and 23 as well. The Mighty One, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting.
Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth.
Our God comes and does not keep silence. before whom is the devouring fire, around about whom is mighty storm.
God calls to the heavens above and to the earth, that the people may be judged.
Gather to me my faithful ones, who made a covenant with me by sacrifice.
The heavens declare God's righteousness, for God alone is judge.
Hear, O my people, and I will speak, O Israel. I will testify against you. I am God, your God.
I do not reprove you for your sacrifices. Your burnt offerings are continually before me.
Mark this, then, you who forget God, lest I rend and there be none to deliver.
Those who bring thanksgiving as a sacrifice, honor me. To those who order their way aright, I will show the salvation of God.
You're invited now to stand as you are able as we reaffirm our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
I want to give everybody an opportunity first to share prayer concerns, and so those who are watching online, you're invited to begin sharing some of those in the comments so that we have time to share those out loud here. And then during the prayer, you will also have a chance, because this is All Saints Sunday, to name some of those people, whether they have died in the last year or those who may have died years and years ago. But who are those saints for you, whose names we can say out loud and remember as we pray. So just be thinking about who some of those people are and whose names you might want to share out loud when we get to that time in the prayer. But as we move to this time of prayer, a few needs that I want to lift up are ones that Mary Hannigan passed along to me. She asked for continued prayers for Terry, as well as continued prayers for her son, Jeff, whose health has not been very good, but who did get to come home from the hospital recently. And so we want to remember Terry and Jeff. What are some of the other prayer needs that we have to share with one another today? Praise and continued prayers for Emily, who's listed in our prayer list for the progress that she has made since that horrific wreck. The continued prayers for her as she continues that journey. Are there any other prayers to share? If there are not, let's join our hearts in the time of prayer. Oh, loving God, we thank you for the gift of your presence with us and for the gift of your presence with those who have gone before us. On this day, we especially lift up in prayer those who are hurting and who are struggling with their health. We lift up Terry Hannigan and Mary's son, Jeff. We ask that you would bring healing and pour out your presence on them as they continue through these things that they face. We lift up Emily and thank you for the progress that she has made and ask that you would continue to wrap your arms around her and her loved ones, her family, that you would give her body strength and give her spirit strength as she continues to heal and as you do your work with her. God, we lift up all those in our community and around our world who might be having hard times and ask that you would use us to be your hands and feet in this world, that they would know they are not alone. God, on the eve of this election week, we know that there are so many desires that all of your people have, and oftentimes those desires conflict and compete with one another. We just ask that you would watch over the decisions that people have already made and decisions that people have yet to make. That you would bring peace and that you would move all of us to participate in this process that many of our ancestors did not all have the right to do. And so we ask that you would use all of us to participate in this situation. We ask that regardless of what happens, that you would give comfort to those who mourn results and give compassion to those who celebrate them. We acknowledge that when we gather next, whenever we know the results of these things, that there will be some in our midst who are hurting and some who are elated, perhaps others who are just relieved. And so we ask that you would allow us to go through these coming days and weeks in a way that has compassion for one another, that shows love and care for one another, and that we would not see the goal of this to be to win at someone else's expense, but that you would help us to work together no matter what the result is, to bring peace and justice and compassion and love more fully into your world. God, on this All Saints Sunday, we lift up those connected to our community who have passed away this past year. We lift up those who are family to Les Jones, Sam Miles, Terry Lee, Golden Oblet, Tommy Reed, Catherine Jones, and Robert Arrowwood. At this time, we ask that you would hear us as we say out loud the names of others who have touched our lives, whose memories we want to remember and celebrate this day. We thank you for these saints. We remember them not because they were perfect, but because they were faithful. We remember them because they were children who you love as much as you love each of us. And so, God, we ask that you would continue to hold these souls in your arms, that you would continue to surround them with your love and presence as we celebrate their life that has no end because of your love and grace. God, we ask that you would form us more fully day by day into the kinds of people who will be remembered by those who come after us for having shaped their faith, for having taught them what it means to love and to serve and to follow your Son, Jesus Christ. And so, God, mold us into the image of not only those saints, but of your Son, Jesus Christ, especially here and now as we pray as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Children's Sunday School. If you'd like, you can go ahead and pull out your coloring page for today. We have a nice picture of Abraham looking up at the stars, and you can start coloring while I begin today's lesson. Oh, did I get my times mixed up? Sorry about that. For anyone who doesn't know me, my name is Zachariah, and I am the Children's Ministry intern here at Mount Zion. Since this is the worship service, I think a good place to start would be with today's sermon reading. Please stand with me as you are able. Today's passage comes from Hebrews chapter 10, verse 36 through 11:16, but I'll be reading from selected passages. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one will live by faith, and I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back. But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for, and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was not looking forward to a city with, or for he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. And by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so, from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and as countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. This is the word of God for all people.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Please join with me in prayer. God, thank you for this opportunity to come before you together, joined in person and online. Please help us to focus on you in this time, and we come expecting a word from you, so please speak through me, but more importantly, please speak into each of our hearts in the way that only you can. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Imagine that you are about 35 years old. You are married, but have lived in the same city as your father, your cousins, uncles, nieces, and aunts for your whole life. Then God suddenly calls out to you saying, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land that I will show you." This is what God said to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, 1. Now, Abraham was actually 75 at this time, but he lived to be 175, so he still had most of his life ahead of him. Imagine all of the plans Abraham would have had for his life, and think how it would have felt for him to hear God say, "Rebut those plans and to follow me instead." Now, maybe some of you have heard the same exact calling from God, but I think that each of us can think of at least one time, no matter how small, that God has asked us to get rid of one of our plans and to follow his will instead. In the fall of 2017, I began studying for what I hoped would lead to a career in NASCAR. I worked hard at this, and in the spring of 2019, I received a certificate in motorsports management and technologies, and I was planning to use this, but about a year earlier, God told me that my career was actually going to be in children's ministry. I was a little surprised at first and nervous, but because I chose to have faith in God's plan, even through fears and doubts, I've had this amazing opportunity to teach the children here at Mount Zion each week and to be with you this morning. Another example of faith that I have looked to over the years is that of my parents. My father, when I was born, was the children's minister at Castlewood Christian Church in Kentucky. My dad had already given much of his life to serving the Lord. He graduated with a bachelor's degree in religion and philosophy from Barton College, which happens to be a conference rival of Southern Wesleyan University. Go Warriors! And my dad also graduated with a master's degree in religious art from Lexington Theological Seminary. He was doing what he loves, serving the Lord. Then my parents felt a calling from God to move from Kentucky to North Carolina, where they had each grown up. They felt that God was calling them to raise their new family around their own families. My parents prayed about this and decided to follow God's calling, and my dad searched for a church in North Carolina where he could work at. Similarly to Pastor Jonathan's story last week, none of the churches that my dad applied for chose him to be the children's minister. My dad finally took a job in a warehouse while he continued to search, but to this day, my dad has not received another job in a church. This may make you wonder if it really was God's will for us to move to North Carolina, and I think that my dad had some of the same doubts at times. I watched my dad. He never expressed these, in fears and worries, but that he always loved continuing to serve in the church. We were always one of the first families to get to church and leave on Sunday mornings, and he has taught children's Sunday school as a volunteer. But he had studied so hard for this to be his career, and so he was wondering if this was God's will. But I know for many reasons that it was, and one of which is that I have spoken to some of my dad's co-workers at the warehouse. One shared with me how she is inspired by my father's Christ-like love that he shares at work, even when he is asked to do more work than normal. Another shared how he is inspired and grew in his faith by a book that he read that he saw my dad like. And finally, one woman shared with me how she had begun to fall away from her faith, but after having several conversations with my father and other people at church, she chose to come back to church regularly. And so, even when God's plan doesn't make sense to us, he puts us in places that he wants us to serve. And so God's plan and God's will always work out if we choose to have faith in him. Another story of faith specific that I want to share with you today, because today is All Saints Day, and we remember the faith of those who have gone before us, especially those who have passed in the previous year. And Sam Miles is one of those saints. Before today, I talked to his daughter Serena about if I could share a story of Sam's faith. And when talking with her, I realized that this might seem ironic to some of you, because normally Sam was the one who would tell the stories. Sam loved to share how he saw God moving, even in the smallest of details. One of Sam's most common examples to share was that of the day of his second heart attack. This, even though this occurred on the same day as Easley's annual 4th of July celebration, the ambulance, there was no pedestrians or vehicles on Main Street in Easley as the ambulance was coming through. God also made sure that the ambulance received all green lights and an impromptu police escort all the way to Greenville Hospital's emergency room doors. Finally, the doctors were able to complete a 5-way bypass, even though the aneurysm should have already burst. It was occasions like these that led Sam to create what Serena calls the three ways that God heals. Sam would say, God can heal you with the knowledge and skill that he provides to doctors and nurses. He can heal with a miracle directly from his hand, or with the eternal healing that comes from being called home into God's presence. Sam's faith in these ways that God heals encouraged him to be able to share stories and to tell jokes, even in serious situations. Serena explained to me how the nurses were always inspired and encouraged by the strong faith and high spirits that Sam had. Because of this, it might be surprising for many of you to learn that Sam struggled with depression and suicidal thoughts. That Serena explained that she believes that she is the only one that Sam ever confided this in, but it is true that he had several days and moments where he wondered if life was really worth the trouble and contemplated giving up on everything. But Sam would remember the three ways that God heals and how God had always been faithful to him. And so Sam would take off the unnecessary weight that was upon him and trust in God. That's why Sam's stories always ended on a happy note. Sam would explain that God has always been faithful to us and cared for us, and he will continue to until eternity. Each story that I have shared with you so far, that of myself and of my father and of Sam Miles, were stories about how we had faith in God's plan, but we also had many fears and doubts. And I want to look back at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, to see what it says about faith. Now, faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This seems to suggest that we need to have 100% confidence and assurance in God's plans. So can our stories really be considered stories of faith? And I'm sure many of you have experienced fears and doubts at times. But in this Bible reading, we heard about Abraham, who is often considered the father of faith. Surely, since he is commended for his faith, he would not have experienced some of these same fears and doubts. But let's look to Abraham's story to see what his faith story looked like. I've already shared with you that God called Abraham to go and move to a place that he had never seen before. God would continue to call him in the next 10 years to go and move 7 more times. He was showing Abraham the promised land. And during this time, God blessed Abraham with riches and possessions, and he became very wealthy. God also came to Abraham and spoke with Abraham and encouraged him on several occasions, the third of which can be found in Genesis chapter 15, and I'll begin reading in verse 1. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your shield, your very great reward. Now notice that Abraham didn't have to call out to God, but God came to Abraham. So Abraham must have had a great faith that he was on that level, that God would just come to him. But let's look at Abraham's response in verses 2 through 3. But Abraham said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me, since I remain childless, and the one who will inherit my estate is Eleazar of Damascus? And Abraham said, You have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. Okay, let's all take a few steps back from Abraham a minute, and watch as the pillar of fire comes down to consume him. I mean, Abraham said right to God's face, Your plan has failed. You have not given me any children. How can this work out? But God's response to Abraham, let's watch and see how God actually responds. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. He took him outside and said, "Look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them." Then he said to him, "So shall your offspring be." So God not only does not punish Abraham for his fears and doubts, but God reaffirms the promise with Abraham and tells him that he will have so many descendants that he will not be able to count them. God does not even acknowledge Abraham's fears and doubts, but continues to bless him through it. And Abraham's response in verse 6 is that Abraham believed the Lord, and he credited to him as righteous. Because Abraham chose to act on his faith in God instead of acting on his fears and doubts, God blessed Abraham and commended him for his faith. But this would seem to contradict what we read in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, that faith is confidence and assurance 100%. Now that is a true verse. 100% and perfect faith in God would be confidence and assurance at all times. But we need to remember what Jesus said. He picked up a small, tiny seed, a mustard seed, and said that if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can move mountains, and nothing will be impossible with you through God. So if we have the smallest of faith and we choose to act on that, God will use us to do whatever he calls us to. God reaffirms his promise to us and asks us to persevere in our faith in Hebrews 10, 36, and 39. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. When we choose to act on this faith and persevere through our doubts and fears, God promises us to save us through Jesus and to bless us. We also talked about in Hebrews 11 that God is preparing a city for us who choose to act on faith, or we will be reunited with the saints who have gone before us. We will also have no more fears and doubts. This will be a city where our fears and doubts will finally be wiped away, and we can worship God in that way. So I want to, we are not so different from Abraham after all. We see that Abraham had fears and doubts also, but just like him, we can be commended for our faith. And in your bulletin, I had where you could write in your own name and say, Zachariah is commended for faith, or Matthew is commended for faith. So if you have time now, you can write your name in there or write it in later. But think about that. You are commended by God for your faith when you choose to act on your belief in him. I would like to leave you today with some words from a song by Rich Mullins, who was a contemporary Christian artist. Once he wrote, "Sometimes I think of Abraham, how one star he saw had been lit for me. He was a stranger in this land, and I am that no less than he. And on this road to righteousness, sometimes the climb can seem so steep. I may falter in my steps, but never beyond your reach. Sometimes I think of Abraham. Sometimes I think of Sam Miles. Sometimes I think of my father. Who do you think about?" I encourage you not only on this special Sunday, but in days to come throughout your life, remember the faith of the saints, and may that encourage you to persevere in your own circumstances. Finally, remember the city that has been prepared for those who persevere. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Sermon, I don't know if you know this, but I was thinking back to the first time I ever preached and the butterflies that were everywhere and the nerves, and so thank you for having the courage to get up in front of people and to share that word and to bless us in that way, Zechariah. As we move into this next time with our offerings, we'll be doing something for the first time today in this new way, and that is communion. And so, in a moment, you will have the chance, if you're watching online, to share your offerings online. And if you are here in the sanctuary, to make your way out the doors and to drop your offering in the offering box. And then what we're going to do for communion is there is a table out there at the bottom of the steps where you are invited to squirt some hand sanitizer, clean off your hands, and then there's a basket of the little cups of juice with the wafer, and you can grab one of those. And we're just going to circle up out there and do our communion liturgy together outside and to partake in that together outside, and then we'll give a benediction from there. If you are watching online, then you are invited to let us know in the comments if you would like for us to bring communion to you during the week, and so we can take these elements that we bless today and bring those to you in a safe way. So at this time, let's pray for our offering, and then we will make our way outside for communion. O loving God, we thank you for the many gifts you have given to us. We thank you for the gift of your servants, who give of themselves to lead us. And we thank you especially on this day for Zechariah and John and Barbara and Serena and Benji and all those who have led us in a special way today as we've worshiped. We thank you for the gifts that you have given us to serve you in this world. We thank you for the resources you have provided so that all of us would have our needs met. And so, God, we ask that as we now return back to you what you have first given to us, you would bless what we give you, that you would bless and lead us and guide us in our use of what you have given to us, so that others might know your love and your grace in a powerful way, that others might be touched by your Spirit and grow to see you in a new way. We ask that you bless these offerings that we give, and use them to glorify your name and to build your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. And so we thank you and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, you're invited to make your way out the doors and to leave your offerings in the box and to grab those communion elements. And again, those of you watching online, let us know we'd be happy to bring those elements to you.